Well, here we are, the end of season 4. The shortest and yet in some ways the longest season of this series. We got lots of things to celebrate and some things to mock. So let's get down to business. First, as always, we'll start off with the episodes by score, breaking down each category and how many episodes ended up in that category. First, we have the 0 out of 3 category. Here we had 3 episodes, or 17% of the season. He's Alive, Of Late I Think of Cliffordville, The Incredible World of Horace Ford. Then we have the 1 out of 3 category. Here we had 3 episodes, or 17% of the season. Jess Bell, No Time Like the Past, I Dream of Jeannie. Then we had the 2 out of 3 category. Here we had 8 episodes, or 44% of the season. So the bulk of the season ended up here in this category. In His Image, The 30 Fathom Grave, Valley of the Shadow, Mute, Miniature, The Parallel, Passage on the Lady Anne, The Bard. And finally, we have the 3 out of 3 category, The Cream of the Crop. And here we have 4 episodes, or 22% of the season. Death Ship, Printer's Devil, The New Exhibit, On Thursday We Leave for Home. And here, of course, the highlight of the review, my pie chart. Next, as always, let us celebrate and honour, and in some cases critique, the authors who contributed stories to season 4. We have 7 authors this season, starting with John Faria Jr., who wrote 1 episode, or 6% of the season. Mr. Faria was a prominent and at one time president of the Western Writers Guild of America, and he wrote for many shows. But when push comes to shove, I judge his tale here, not his merits. He gets an overwhelming shrug from me, and with no other contributions to the show, he's easily forgettable. Next, we have Earl Hamner Jr., who wrote 1 episode, or 6% of the season. Mr. Hamner is improving, which is to say his contribution to this season was just a regular bad, and not a so bad I want to murder someone bad. So, a step in the right direction. Next, we have Reginald Rose, who wrote 1 episode, or 6% of the season. He wrote 12 Angry Men, a great play turned into a great film. I'm glad I know he wrote that. And so, I'll assume that his Twilight Zone episode was written in a state of madness, instead of him being a hack writer, like I assumed when I first viewed the work. Next, we have Jerry Soule, a ghostwriter for Charles Beaumont, who wrote 1 episode, or 6% of the season. Great first impression, and I look forward to seeing more. It must be really hard ghostwriting for someone else, but Mr. Soule takes it in stride, delivering a piece that uses the medium to its fullest extent. Next, we have Richard Matheson, who wrote 2 episodes, or 11% of the season. On the topic of using the medium to its fullest extent, Mr. Matheson swoops in to deliver 2 more great stories, in a way that shows me he gets hour-long programs, in a way others could not. As always, thought-provoking and original tales. Let's see what he has for us in season 5. Then we have Charles Beaumont, with 5 episodes, or 27% of the season. Here, in his last season, before illness took his mind, Mr. Beaumont delivers his strongest overall season. These are great, solid-paced stories with great ideas. A fantastic finish to an uneven run on the show. And of course, finally, we have Rod Serling, who wrote 7 episodes, or 38% of the season. Mr. Serling continues to be an impressive writer, but this was without a doubt his weakest season. He just doesn't seem to get longer form stories. He even admitted that he disliked this season because of the change in length. At least he recognizes his weaknesses. I can only hope for a return to form when season 5 rolls around. Here it is, Pie Chart Part 2, Electric Boogaloo. And now, of course, the moment you've all been waiting for, I'm sure. Season 4 had some rough spots, but which ones were so rough that no amount of sanding would smooth them out. Well, here comes my top three worst episodes of season four. In third place, The Incredible World of Horace Ford, episode 117, written by Reginald Rose.
What great times. I was 10. Boy, what great, great times.
Horace, why don't you stop? Nobody cares about when you were 10 anymore.
I care.
You're almost 38.
So what?
You don't act 38 sometimes.
So what?
That's what I mean. So what? What kind of an answer is so what?
I'm telling you, it's dry.
Why do you keep talking about when you were a kid? I mean, all the time.
Now that's pretty.
Why don't you just be quiet for once, will you?
What's worse than being stuck with a whiny and immature man-baby? Being stuck with a whiny and immature man-baby for 50 minutes. An epic failure in trying to display nostalgia in a way that not only irritates, but also damages the fragile subject of mental health awareness. This was such an easy fix. If only someone in the production effort had realized what a terrible character they were making. I feel sorry for every character who had to interact with this awful person. The wife deserves a medal for her patience, and I deserve a medal for sitting through this. In second place, Of Late I Think of Cliffordville, episode 116, written by Rod Serling.
I happen to know for a fact that you secured a loan for $3 million, a loan payable on demand. Here is the note. I bought up that note, Mr. Dietrich. I paid an exorbitant amount of money for it, more than it was worth. But it was, well, shall I say, an excellent opportunity. An opportunity for our lives to crisscross again. So, to the point.
This was the season for terrible character design, it would seem. I don't know who to blame more for this wretched character study about a guy I never ever wanted to meet. But I'm willing to toss mud on everyone's face for this. Idiotic dialogue, childish and incomplete morals, and a plot so full of holes it would be better off as a slice of Swiss cheese. Of late, I think about how awful this story was. And the worst episode of season 4 is... He's Alive, episode 106, written by Rod Serling.
They lead directly to the Vatican! So there we are, there it is. There is a conspiracy, there's an insidious, enveloping conspiracy. A conspiracy personified by the yellow man, by the black man, and by foreigners who come in and infiltrate into our economic structure.
Does Rod Serling really hate his audience that much? He must have been really having a bad time to have penned this. I have said that Mr. Serling, even at his best, can come off a bit patronizing. And at his worst, he is a condescending, spiteful man who thinks everyone watching the show is a stupid monkey who needs to be reminded that Nazis are bad. This is the one with Hitler in it. That's all I should have to say before you go running off in terror from this abomination. Every character is an arsehole, the dialogue sounds like a social science essay, and the plot sounds like it was made up at an improv show. Skip it. Please. Though this season was a bit underwhelming, we did have several bright spots that made the most of the new length and told great stories. So here is my top three best episodes of season 4. In third place, The New Exhibit, episode 115, written by Jerry Soule.
That's what I'm going to do. It'll be no less than you deserve. All right. Now, which one of you is first? Which one of you is first? You. Because you murdered Mr. Ferguson.
A true psychological thriller and brilliant character study that takes full advantage of its runtime to create a believable atmosphere of dread and suspense. This could have been a cheap thrill episode about murderous wax figures, but the ambiguity of the ending and the masterful handling of mental obsession adds extra layers to this tale that make it worth watching and remembering. In second place, Printer's Devil, episode 111, written by Charles Beaumont.
If you aren't going to, perhaps you wouldn't mind giving me a lift into town? Now, I don't want you to change your plans on my behalf, you understand?
Come on.
Well, thank you. Wait a minute. I found a light.
This just might be Mr. Beaumont's finest work on the show. A story that uses the cliché deal with the devil setup to deliver a powerful moral tale about all things in life carrying a cost, and for us to ponder that cost before we do anything. It also manages to provide commentary on those that choose to look the other way when bad things happen, instead of doing something about it. Everything from the pacing, to the idea of the linotype machine, to casting Mr. Meredith in what is essentially the proto-penguin, was brilliantly done. And the best episode of season 4 is On Thursday We Leave for Home, episode 118, written by Rod Serling.
There are changes that have taken place on Earth that none of us are prepared for. Now these people, they make it seem like a big holiday. Like everything's easy, like the good life, you can just pluck it off a tree. Well, my people, I don't want any one of you to be disillusioned. I tell you now that wherever men live, they grovel and they struggle. They dig to stay alive. This I know.
Ah, Mr. Serling, there you are. It took a while, but you figured out the format just in time to deliver this beautiful, poetic look at what authority can do to us. A perfectly human tale of how absolute power really can corrupt absolutely in a subtle and moving way, where we both hate and pity our protagonist by the end. Mr. Serling has said himself that he was never happy with season 4 because of the format change, but he was pleased with this tale. I concur. I'm pleased this exists, and I will say it again. If there is only one episode of this season that you bother watching, make sure it's this one. You can thank me later. 4 down, 1 to go. I can't wait to share the final 36 episodes with you. See you there when we head back to the Twilight Zone.